Well, good afternoon. Before I came to Stanford, I was a researcher at Daimler-Benz, the parent company of Mercedes. And I got to spend some time in Germany. Now, the best part of that assignment was that on Fridays, I could sign out one of the research vehicles and take it to explore the country a little bit. Now, one day I would show up, and it would be a car that looked blue from one direction and green from the other. Or it would have the paint scheme of a tomato. Or it had a stop-start button from the stick shift. But one Friday I showed up, and the car looked, well, shockingly normal. There was nothing obviously different about it other than the dashboard, where there was a big red button, helpfully labeled Achtung. And I asked the head of the research fleet, I said, what's going on with this? And he explained to me that the car had an experimental engine that was going to self-destruct at some point. And if that happened to be while I was driving on my way from Stuttgart to Munich, I should hit the big red button. Now, I'm trying to figure out, with this car in the ball of flames, what good is that possibly going to do? Is it a James Bond ejector seat? So my mind's racing for a bit, and I finally ask, what does that do? And he says, oh, it saves the data. Now, normally when you see a big red button, it's an emergency stop button. It's something that the engineer has put there to make sure that a human ultimately has the authority over what an automated system does. That's what we use them for in my lab at Stanford, where we're working on designing safe self-driving cars. Our goal is to design a self-driving car that can handle emergency situations even better than the very best human drivers. And the first step in doing that is to make sure that they have phenomenal driving skills. To do this, we've started with P1. This is an entirely student-built, steer-by-wire electric vehicle that we put together with a project with Nissan. A team of 5 Stanford students in 15 months took this from a clean sheet of paper to the first moving test. Now, obviously, as you can see, they didn't spend a lot of time with the rich Corinthian leather and the body panels. But what they did do was make it highly programmable. And in 2008, we programmed it to learn how to drift. Here you see P1 executing a perfect drift on the Galvez lot. Despite the uneven and slippery surface, it's able to maintain stability and control. P1 does this by very careful control of the steering and the rear drive wheels. It's able to maintain this drift as long as it wants, where mere mortals would result in a spin. The students here are just along for the ride, enjoying it while keeping one hand next to the big red button. From P1, we moved on to Shelley, a mostly stock Audi TTS, where we added a few sensors and extra computing power. Now, we've turned Shelley into a self-driving race car, and Shelley and her team have had all sorts of adventures. We took her in 2009 to the Bonneville Salt Flats, where we raced at speeds well over 130 miles an hour. The next year, it was off to Pikes Peak in Colorado, where we had to get up really early in the morning, so before the Pikes Peak Highway opened, we could set up all of the equipment in the dark, so at the first light of dawn, Shelley could tackle the 153 turns of the Pikes Peak hill climb. Now, as you notice, many of these turns have sheer drops and no guardrails, so we thought it was actually a better investment to take the students out of the car. So they monitored the experiment from abroad, sitting there outside the car with one finger on the big red button, until we safely got to the top of the summit. Now, Shelley has gone on from mountains to racetracks, where she spends most of her time now, and we've learned some other uses of the big red button, particularly when we gave David Pogue a ride in the car for an episode of Nova.
Okay, so I'm not doing anything right now.
This is not slowing down very much at the curb.
No, we really don't have to.
It just went off the road, dude.
If you don't go up on the rimble strip, then you're slow. Any race car driver will tell you that.
What a smart little car.
Shelley is constantly adjusting her position on the track. Her adjustments just aren't very smooth. But I guess smooth doesn't matter if your only priority is staying on the road.
Chris. Something.
You okay?
Oh, my God.
Fortunately, Chris can take over at any time.
And that wasn't what we had in mind when we put in the emergency stop. But it turns out it's really, really important because unlike P1, Shelley has very, very nice interior upholstery. Now, we're not the only ones who've done this. You've no doubt seen Google's automated vehicle, and if you look at the center console, what do you see? A big red button, even when the driver is blind. Now, this is a dream for many people of the automated vehicle, something that can take you from point A to point B without you ever having to touch the wheel or without your hand hovering over an emergency stop. To get there, the car must not only be able to drive phenomenally well, it must be able to make decisions, and very important ones. So imagine you're on your way here today on the 210, and you're driving in an automated vehicle. It can stay in its lane perfectly. But the person in the lane next to you suddenly swerves into you. What should your car do? It's your car. You love your car. Shouldn't it feel the same way about you? Shouldn't it do everything it can to protect you? Or should your car deal out justice? Should it say it was this person's fault? They should get the worst damage. Hey, we know these things can slide sideways. Should it jump into the other lane and avoid this accident? But what if that raises a possibility of an accident with somebody who otherwise wouldn't have been involved? Is that the right thing to do? These are no longer questions of technical feasibility and what the car can do. These are ethical questions of what the car should do. And at this point, we have to wonder, can we even call it a car anymore? Or is this device that's making these life or death decisions really a robot? This is exactly the question I'm exploring right now with Patrick Lin, a philosopher and robot ethicist at Cal Poly. If this starts to sound a little bit like science fiction, you're right. In fact, the first proposal for ethical frameworks for robotics came from science fiction writer Isaac Asimov. In Asimov's world, robot brains are programmed with three laws so that they can safely coexist with humans. And those laws are: a robot may not injure a human being or, through inaction, allow a human being to come to harm. A robot must obey the orders given it by human beings, except where such orders would conflict with the first law. And a robot must protect its own existence, as long as such protection does not conflict with the first or second law. Now, philosophers will tell you this is not a complete framework for ethics. Science fiction fans will tell you that many of Asimov's plot lines and Will Smith's movie I, Robot depended upon the ambiguities and loopholes in these laws. And roboticists will tell you, well, you know, current robots aren't programmed to think that way. I mean, my Roomba does not spend much time dwelling on these questions. But when you think of self-driving cars, thinking about the ethical issues drives you in some very interesting directions. Let's start with the very first law. If my self-driving car is to avoid injuring human beings, first of all, it has to recognize, what is a human being? Now, as you look around the room today, it's pretty easy to spot the humans in the room. You haven't had much difficulty with that. But you see with your eyes and your brain. The world to a self-driving car looks like a bunch of pixels in a digital camera or lines from a laser scanner, such as on this Ford Fusion. It doesn't see what you see. The car has to take what it senses and turn it into a picture of the reality. Now, obviously, the laser scanner can see 360 degrees. That's a huge advantage over us. But if you sort of look at what it sees, you can make out shapes of people around it, but not the details. Very different from your brain. And those details can sometimes be important. If we don't want to injure a human being, we shouldn't hit anything that's hard. But how can this tell the difference between something that fell off the back of a pickup truck, a tumbleweed, a ball in the street? Do I hit it, or must I make an emergency maneuver to go around it? These are things that our brain does extremely well, recognize objects and put them in context. For a machine, it's not so easy. Well, at any rate, if something goes wrong, we don't always hit the big red button, right? Well, maybe not. If you think about it, the laws say that the robot must obey the orders given to it by a human being unless it senses that there's an emergency. Could it be in the future that my self-driving car thinks it can better handle the situation than I can? I hit the big red button, and suddenly it says, "I'm sorry, Chris. I'm afraid I can't do that." Now, we think to like to put these ethical considerations front and center in our minds so we understand the conflicts that can occur. As engineers, we're inspired to make sure that they don't. While perception and these technologies improve, can we actually have the car share control with the human to steer together to create a harmonious, ethical, and intuitive shared control? Here you see this happening right now on our student-driven vehicle, X1. It's being driven by Steve Erlian, and the car is nudging him and guiding him as he takes it through the cones. I can say much more about this, but Steve, Holly Russell, and the Car X1 are here today. I encourage you to talk to them, to share their enthusiasm, and see how their ideas and inspiration are driving us into the future. But until we get there, I'm keeping one hand on the big red button. Thank you.